Thank you for attending my talk on Drupal in the hip-hop virtual machine. I hope you enjoyed the intro music. It's an honor to be here in Amsterdam presenting to all you fine, wonderful people. Who am I? My name is Josh. I've been involved in the Drupal project for 11 years now, which makes me feel old. But also, you know, I've got some experience and I've done a few things. Started a couple companies. I used to do a lot of trainings. I put out a virtual machine image back when that was the hip thing to do that integrated a lot of Drupal performance stuff called Project Mercury that some folks liked. And I helped found a company called Pantheon that is very interested in making everyone's Drupal websites faster because that's an important part of getting Drupal to run a non-trivial portion of the internet, which is one of my goals. All right, so I'm going to start by going back into time, and we're going to go back to, let's say, like 2007, 2008. This is around the time of the Open Source CMS Summit. If anybody saw the pre-note where Dries talked a little bit about, like, they went to this conference at Yahoo's campus in Sunnyvale, and that's where he met the Jay Batson and decided to found Acquia. This is a time period I want to talk about. This is a time when the core PHP project was in a state of relative disarray. It was a kind of a dark age for PHP, to be quite honest. I think PHP, like a lot of open source projects, was a victim of its own success in the sense that, you know, it sort of came out in the late 90s and as the first language templating system that was expressly built and designed for the web, and with the web just exploding as a use case at that time, it got very popular very quickly, and then it got deployed very widely very quickly when it was still in a relatively immature state. It gets tricky. Like, you think about all the problems that we have in Drupal with the angst within the community over moving to Symfony Core and the concerns around whether or not this would be too difficult for people to use and the questions around what is the right path to upgrade people. You know, PHP had this problem writ very large at that time. This was a period of time where people were openly questioning whether PHP 5 was even viable. It was a time when there were, within the core project itself, differences of opinion that didn't seem to be reconcilable to the point where people would go in late at night and revert other people's commits, and then like they would fight about it in IRC. Like, just unhealthy community mojo. You had people who left the project. There was a lot of turmoil, and I think for me, it was around that time that I had started a business that was based on Drupal. We did a consultancy called Chapter 3 in San Francisco. And we were worried about that. We thought, oh my God, well, what's going to happen with PHP? Is it really going to have legs, or is PHP going to kind of like stagnate and collapse? And what will that mean for the business that we're building? What will that mean for Drupal? We were worried about it. It was like PHP was carrying this lead weight behind it of all the 4.x implementations on all the crappy shared hosts in the world. And there was all this software that was written within that paradigm that was like, frankly, not the greatest quality software in the world. Now, it was doing a very important job. You had all these bulletin boards, you had these like early blog tools, and so forth. But when Drupal first emerged and kind of started to gain popularity in the PHP world, there was a clear difference between the quality of engineering that went into Drupal and its APIs and its architecture and many of the other PHP projects of that era. And these other PHP projects, though, were deployed very widely, used by a lot of people. And, you know, one thing that people really hate is when their host tells them that they have to change their software because of an upgrade. That's just like, no, my software works fine. Keep it as it is. And so there's this kind of stalemate that was occurring. And then within the PHP community itself, within the world of PHP development, you had Pear and Peckle, which were kind of like the packaging tools that you would use to maybe be able to distribute library code, hopefully, sort of, but probably not as much as you would want. And they were not amazing tools. And it was sort of like we didn't have the services around. We had all this legacy, and there was open doubt as to whether this would all work out or whether people would just quit. And Ruby on Rails was the new hotness, and that was just going to like take over everything. And all the things that people still I work out in Silicon Valley, and a lot of people look down their nose at PHP developers, and they like will scoff at PHP and kind of trash talk it a little bit. And some of that is well-deserved because PHP is a little YOLO and does some things that are maybe not the best in the world, but it does a lot of things that are also very valuable. And I think a lot of that derision is a hangover from this period of time. I actually believe, as I'm going to demonstrate, that PHP has come a long way since then and is actually headed in a very good direction. And as PHP developers, I assume everybody here, you're a PHP developer, otherwise why would you be in my talk? We should have some more pride in our work and the language that we work in, because it's not that bad. We have better organizational tools now. I think this was one of the key changes, was with the amount of energy and positive action in the general PHP space changed enormously with the advent of Composer. And the idea that there was a way to now start to very nicely, effectively, and efficiently build projects that leveraged other people's existing code, as opposed to before where it was like, nah, you know, just like commit it, you know, just stuff that in there and then deploy that thing and put this tarball here and maybe run Peckle something or other and hope that works. Composer is a major step forward in terms of the ability for the people building on top of PHP to work as a coherent community together and to share their advances and enable, you know, us to stand on one another's shoulders, which is an important part of building better software. It also helped promote a lot of the working groups implementation so that there was standardization of how you would load other people's code and so on and so forth. That's the PSRs, but Composer makes it fairly easy to get going with a structure that allows you to comply with those things. It's a big change. Helped out a lot of people. Also, the internals of PHP started to get working again. And I think that some of that was people got burned out and left the project, and some hard decisions were made about deprecating 4.0 and saying, no, we're not going to continue to support that. And if you're a crappy shared host, you have to deal with that. That's just the way it is. We're moving forward. We're not going to be stuck where we are now just because of all this legacy. And PHP 5 gained momentum, and actually PHP 5 up until, you know, is continuing to improve. The internals of PHP are actually getting better with every release. Language features are improving, performance is improving, and I think that the trend line is actually very good for the project in and of itself. And I think that Facebook did something pretty interesting when they decided essentially to double down on PHP. I clearly wasn't in there. Yeah, I know one guy that works at Facebook, and I've talked with some of their hip-hop virtual machine people, which I'll talk about later in the presentation. So I don't have any insider knowledge, but I imagine there was this kind of like tense meeting at some point where they were like, Facebook's really taking off. Everyone's doing good. High five, cool. Except we have to run so many servers just to get like keep up with the load here, and we're going to have to start on data center number 3 like now unless we can do something about this. So they had a number of moonshot projects. And one of them was like they started to like redesign like a whole operating system just to run the server internals more efficiently and effectively. I don't know whether that actually worked out or not. They did some other things. And somebody had the crazy idea that, hey, what if we reverse compiled PHP into native C code programmatically and then just deployed this binary on our platform instead of running the PHP? And I'm sure that people laughed at that idea because it sounds crazy, but it actually worked. It turned out that they were able to do that, and they were able to almost double their process density on their existing systems, which when you're thinking about the expense of breaking ground on a new data center is a major, major game changer for your company. It's also like a great technology in terms of like, you know, efficient use of resources. And more than just doing that internally, they decided that this would be something they would try to do in open source to demonstrate that they're, you know, going to stick with PHP. That injected some energy into the community. It also created a sense of competition where it's like, well, hey, PHP core community, Zend, you guys got to really start to step up your game here, because it's not just like, you know, the Facebook's going to solve all the problems. It's if you want to continue to be relevant, you're going to have to compete with people that are offering solutions that are this far outside the box and deliver this good of an improvement. So I think the competition that started as a result of that has driven a lot of the positive changes in the PHP world. And this is important because PHP is the most popular language on the web by a wide margin. The second most popular, it depends on whose statistics you look at, but it's usually ASP.NET. It's Microsoft's language. So everyone who's built, it's basically PHP is the clear leader in open source web stuff. The next leader is people who are doing closed source web stuff, the Microsoft folks, and peace be unto them. And then behind that are like Ruby and Node and all the other things, and Java, et cetera. And so PHP is out there, it's big, it's what we all use, it's what millions of other developers use, and it's very important that it continues to improve. And I think that we're actually seeing that. I like to say that PHP is undergoing a renaissance right now. Hashtag PHP renaissance. Please use that in all your tweets, right, if you feel like it. And it's actually a very exciting time to be a PHP developer. So have some pride. You are part of a renaissance, and we are making most of the internet better in the work that we do. That's cool. So now I'm going to talk about performance. That was a sort of preamble. We're discussing performance. That's why you all are here, I presume, right? You want your websites to run faster, and you want to know whether or not some of these technologies can actually help, right? Yeah. Okay. Cool. So I will caveat a little bit in that I think that performance is actually a multifaceted challenge, and that there are three major buckets I currently think of performance, website performance, as being in. You have the runtime, which is what we'll talk about today. That's the engine that runs your code. But actually delivering a high-performance experience to your users requires an optimized front end, which I think is actually the real frontier for performance now. Like a lot of the stuff that I'm going to demonstrate or show in the runtime, it's all happening, it's all good, and it's important to be up on. But the place where new techniques and the ability to really wow people at the other end of websites is happening is on the front end. So if you're a performance geek and you're not into front end performance yet, and you're not up on all the new techniques there, I would suggest sort of diving into some of that while you're here. And then on the back end, of course, database performance is still incredibly important, and I/O can kill your site. So when thinking about performance, obviously, cache rules everything around me. As Powell Henning Camp, the author of Varnish, likes to say, it's just caches all the way down, from your browser to the L2 cache on the processor that's serving the response for your web page. There's like 60 caches in between and probably some more still in there. But what this talk is about is when you can't cache, right? So caching is a solution when you don't need to dynamically generate a response. But when you do need to dynamically generate a response, well, you need to engage your engine. Front-end performance is still make or break, so you can't. This is not a talk. You can have the fastest engine in the world, and if you're serving a terribly constructed DOM with a bunch of slow-loading external responses, your users will not care that you lovingly handcrafted the engine that is so fast, because they will be sitting there waiting for the browser to render the result. If your render takes 3 or 4 seconds, it doesn't matter that you started it within 200 milliseconds. It still feels slow. So you can't ignore the front end. And SQL is still really the king of non-linear performance degradation. This is the type of performance degradation that will crash websites. So in a lot of cases, when you're talking about lackluster performance at an engine level, what you see is increased utilization and decreased response times as it takes longer to deliver responses, and then user requests start to queue, and it's sort of like a linear degradation of performance. With 10 users it was okay, with 100 users it started to level off, with 200 users it was pretty bad. When you have a problem with your SQL and you have the query of death somewhere lurking in your Drupal site, I know none of you have ever had that problem, but I've heard stories of people where they had a view that generated a lot of joins, and it turned out that when it was run under certain circumstances, it was an unpleasant experience. That's the case where when you have you go from one user and it's coping to two users and it's slow to three users and the site's dead and it's over until the database can recover from trying to generate all those queries. So don't ignore your SQL. Don't ignore your external services either. But in terms of the engine, the actual execution of code, that is where we have some real potential to make benefits. We're taking advantage of the improving internals of PHP and the improved engine. So the time it takes to literally execute the code is a non-trivial chunk of the time that users wait to see your site. And if you can make that faster, your users will get the results faster, you'll be happier. Happy to report that there's a lot of stuff going on that can improve that. So there are actually many engine upgrades that are currently out there, and I feel the need to mention the ones that I'm not going to talk about in depth, so I'm not slighting anyone. So PHP NG, who's heard of that? So cool. PHP NG is a very intensive rewrite of PHP that is going to be, I hear from authoritative sources, the basis of PHP 7. PHP 7 is actually the next major release of PHP. They're going to skip PHP 6. That's true. And it's a hangover. Well, Microsoft is skipping Windows 9, so it's not unprecedented. It's also a hangover from a lot of the disagreements. It was I think there was just a bunch of people who disagreed about direction enough that they just said, let's just take this whole idea of PHP 6 and throw it out the window, and we'll just talk about PHP 7. And it made it so much easier to talk about things because there's no baggage. They just went with it. So that's, moving forward is important. There's also the Hippie VM, great name. It's another re-engineering of PHP that uses a sort of a Python virtual machine, the PyPy, the same concept as the PyPy project. It seems very good. They claim to have really amazing benchmarks, but they have no official releases, and we'll have to see if what comes of that. They're kind of like looking for contributors, so if you're like want to work in that context, you should check out their project. And there's also the Recce CT project, which Sam Boyer forced me to mention since he worked on something that was used in it. And it's an interesting idea. It's essentially a compiler for PHP written in PHP that produces a binary object and is like totally not ready for prime, but seems kind of interesting and is being built by this guy who works at Google. So there's a lot of stuff going on. This is part of the competition in the space that I think is very, very important. But I'm here to talk about the hip-hop virtual machine. Again, a project that came out of Facebook's hip-hop project. Hip-hop was originally HPHP, HP-PHP, high-performance PHP. And then it turns out that PHP, one of the few restrictions that they do place on derivative projects is to not use PHP in the name to prevent confusion. So HP-PHP became hip-hop, which is, you know, you can see how that happens. And originally it was this, it was a machine-generated compiler, compiling process that would analyze your PHP code and reverse engineer it back to the resulting C code and give you a big binary that you could run. When this first came out, actually, David and I looked at it for Drupal, and yes, you could compile Drupal with it, and yes, it was faster, but the resulting binary was almost 1 gigabyte in size and took something like 20 to 30 minutes to build. So it didn't seem like it was really a viable option for most of us. But the idea was clearly sound. Like it had some benefits. And having talked with some people at Facebook, they actually the fact that worked allowed them to say, okay, we're going to double down on PHP because this will solve our we have to build more data centers problem. But they had a huge amount of friction with that internally as well, because if you think about it, as a developer, do you really want to sit around, and even if you've got a more lightweight app than Drupal, it's still a long compile process, do you really want to sit through a 20 to 30 minute build before you know whether your stuff worked or not? No, you don't, right? You're going to continue to just develop in PHP and look at it in a browser and take advantage of the dynamic compilation, and then only after you've done a lot of work will you try to compile it, and then you'll be frustrated when it doesn't work, and you'll have to go back, and debugging it becomes this a laborious process. And so they embarked on the hip-hop virtual machine project, which was essentially trying to take the available computer science expertise and algorithmic acumen of just-in-time compilation and apply it to the notion of doing a compiled PHP runtime. And so I won't get into the internals of how all that works, but basically they're able to do something that's much more like a Java virtual machine using the same essential concept. And so it doesn't take, there's no compile step. It starts running, the first request takes a few extra seconds, kind of similar to if your APC cache is cold, but subsequent requests, it actually dynamically optimizes depending on what your application's doing, which is cool. But more importantly, as a developer, you don't need to go through a compile step to see the results. And that was, they were able to get all their developers then on board with the notion of using HHVM in the development process, and they stopped having all these kind of ops versus dev fights that nobody likes. Also, HHVM includes its own flavor or iteration or different language, if you will, of PHP called hack, which is essentially PHP with strong typing. So you can say this variable is really only going to be this type of variable, and it's no longer like YOLO variable, whatever. And that is something that they find internally useful or in trying to promote, because it's just, leads to some better engineering decisions when you can strongly type your stuff and you have fewer unexpected side effects and so on and so forth. And there's some interesting tools internally within HHVM if you're ever interested in transitioning from vanilla PHP to something more like hack. They have some debuggers and profilers and loggers that can help you do that. I won't get into that either today, because we're here to talk about performance. So I wired up some stuff on Pantheon to use HHVM. as well as using two other versions of PHP. And I used Panoply as my test case. So Panoply is a distribution that has a bunch of panels in it and some views. Panels known or often thought to cause performance problems. I typically don't think it's panels itself. It's more that it lets you do something like stick 8 views on one page, and that can cause problems. But regardless, panels is a hefty amount of code. And all in all, Panoply has over 100 modules. So this is an example of a big Drupal build, which is the sort of place where you would expect to see improvements at the engine level to deliver a non-trivial improvement in performance. And I did it all on the same instances otherwise, so that there's no other like changes in the architecture around the site for the test. You know, we didn't substitute out a different web server or anything. They're not running on different hardware. There have been a lot of kind of fishy benchmarks that have floated around HHVM, and part of my motivation for doing this summer was to try to do something that was we could really hang our hat on and say, is there a there? Is this worth really looking into? Does it actually improve things? So the first set of benchmarks and it's just I tested it, you know, basically with curl. Turn off all caching, turn off everything else that Drupal might do to be fast, and just see how quickly it can respond to page requests. That was the basic test. So all three versions work. So PHP 5.3, PHP 5.5, and HHVM, they all work. You can boot Drupal in all of them. You can run Panoply in all of them without any apparent problems that I could see. I've tested a few other websites in there, but obviously we'll talk a little bit more at the end about what next steps might mean. But the first good news was they all worked. That's cool. And the results of the benchmark were... it's not 1,000 times faster by any stretch, but the results were significant, and I'm happy to share those findings with you. So first is the vanilla, what we run currently and what I think a lot of people are running on, which is PHP 5.3 tuned with a proper APC configuration and trying to make everything else as good as it can be. In our instance, we run it behind Nginx as an FPM worker process. You might have it compiled into or running in Apache as mod PHP. The differences there are not going to be significant. So this is kind of our baseline result. We had, we were able to get just over 11 requests per second, and each request was the 98th percentile response time was just over half a second. So that means that 98% of the requests came back within half a second. Some of them came back quicker, but you kind of want to take that percentile-based judgment when you're benchmarking a website, because if half your responses are really fast, but the other half are really slow, it's probably not that good. You need almost all your responses to be pretty speedy. You might accept one of them being slow, because that could have been some networking or whatever else. The next step was to bump it up to PHP 5.5, which includes some improved internals. Oh, just one second. And the new opcode cache that replaces APC. And it got faster, non-trivially faster, which I was really happy to see. PHP 5.5 is out there right now. It's pretty well supported. And I think Drupal should run on it with very few problems. And so we were able to get 14.3 requests per second, so that's three more requests per second out of the same runtime. And critically, those requests came back almost a tenth of a second faster. That in and of itself is not going to solve your performance problem, but I also think it's a real benefit to give to users. And if you're concerned with trying to get down to the under 1 second render time in browsers, every tenth of a second helps. You had a question?
Was it with or without the page cache?
This is all with no caching. Testing this with page caching would be pointless. The whole idea here is that we want to exercise the entire code path that's required to render pages in a relatively thick stack of Drupal modules. If you you could do an alternate benchmark, which is what does it look like if I have Varnish in front of it? And it's so fast. But that and that's good. You should run Varnish in front of everything. And if you're not, why not? But that's not a solution to a slow website. I actually see this a lot, a slight digression, but I will rant on this for a second. People put together websites that are not performant. They're slow. They're legitimately hogs. And the queries of death are lurking somewhere in there that will take the website down under certain circumstances. And they think that because you can turn on caching, that's okay. It's not okay. It's not okay, because you're basically, look, you are going to have a moment when your cache gets flushed. You are going to have a moment where you can't cache something. You're going to have a moment where an admin decides to click around and load three pages and three tabs. Whatever it is, if your back end is that slow, you're basically walking around with a loaded gun pointed at your head, waiting for something to go wrong. You need to have really, you really should have high performance, best in class caching, because that's how you deliver a really great user experience, and it's how you can weather massive surges in traffic from, you know, internet things going viral or whatever else. But if you're relying on that for your site performance, you need to go back and make your site really performant, because a cached, this is how all the old stupid enterprise content management systems did it, and it's one of the reasons why other tools emerged. So don't just rely on caching. So end of digression and rant. For this site, all caching is off, except for the opcode cache. So all caching in it's caches all the way down, right? So all caching in front of the website is off. So any page, no page cache, no varnish. And I clocked this with New Relic while it was going on between PHP 5.3 and 5.5 to make sure that it was doing what we thought it would be doing. So it went back and ran this in response to some feedback I got in DrupalCon Austin, which is the entirety of the performance gain here is in reducing the PHP execution time. It does nothing to the database time, and we would not expect it to do anything to the database query time. So if you are analyzing the performance of your website and you are seeing that like 3 to 4 seconds is going into database queries and, you know, only a half a second is going into PHP, then this would help, but it's not where you should be focusing. You should be focusing on reducing that database query time, either by optimizing your queries or reducing them in number or getting better database infrastructure or all of the above. But it's good to see that the results, the improvements came from the place where we expected them to come from. That's what we would expect to see, and I think that validates the findings are there. So then the final benchmark is what happened with HHVM, and this is the benchmark was run with HHVM 3.1. They're up to 3.3 now, which is a long-term release. I'll talk about that a little bit in a second. But the results were really good. Right? We got up to almost 21.5 requests per second, and we shaved yet another 100 milliseconds off the response time. So, and if you want to do a side-by-side comparison, if I was going to make a hypey number, I would say, well, look, PHP 5.3 was 509, and this was like almost 250. So it's twice as fast. Right? It's not really twice as fast. It's the PHP execution is almost twice as fast. And that's not trivial, but it's, again, not going to like solve your slow hog of a website problem if you have that problem. I'm sure none of you have that problem. Just to graph that out for you as a notion, so this is what the speed improvements look like. Again, it's actually kind of interesting to me that the improvements here are almost linear between the versions. I don't think there's any reason for that, but I thought it was interesting. According to what other people have told me, PHP NG, which will be the basis for PHP 7, has similar benefits in terms of improvements in engine performance. My concern there is that PHP 7 is unknown when that will be available, when it will be released, how big of a change it is, whereas I believe that HHVM is rapidly approaching a point of maturity where we can take it seriously now. And so, like, this is a speed improvement you can get now, and they're committed to continuing to improve things. PHP 7 will also be good, but, again, competition is nice, but here's an option I think we can probably start using today. So speed, this is what you care about as a website developer who cares about your users. Scale is something you probably care about, but that's something as a platform operator that I actually care about a lot more, because this means that I don't have to build more data centers. In Facebook's case, they actually calculated that since implementing HHVM, they have saved themselves from actually 5x their application hardware cost. So that's like actually a very green technology when you think about it, because that would mean four more, I'm not quite sure how they did that calculation, 4 to 5 more data centers out there consuming electricity, being built, requiring people to run. So this is technology doing what it's supposed to do. And I think, you know, that's not for nothing. That's a good thing. This is what I mean when I talk about the PHP Renaissance. Like, we are all moving in a very exciting direction, and it's good to be a part of this. this moment. But performance remains a full stack challenge, right? The ultimate answer here is that you have to care about all this stuff if you want your users to have a great experience. This is simply one thing that I'm very excited about potentially helping people in terms of shaving time off and being more efficient. So it's a full stack challenge, and I encourage you to dig in. And that is the extent of my prepared presentation, but I'm happy to take questions if anybody has them. Do you mind using the mic, sir?
What is the language compatibility? So some sites going from 5.3 to 5.5 have some issues. Going from, you know, ones were on 5.2 had problems.
Yeah.
What's the story there?
So the story there is, this is a good thing to get into. So I talked to Sarah a bunch about this. The story there is there are certain things where the HHVM team does not care to support stuff that you can do in PHP. Examples there would be variables. And some interesting pass-by-reference permutations. However, from what I can tell, none of those things are relied on heavily by Drupal core or by the 100 modules that went into Panoply. That said, there's a lot of contrib out there, and there's a lot of custom code. And so the best way that I can think of to kind of test this would be to actually begin to experiment with it with your site. And I believe, based on the statements made by the people working at Facebook, that they're very interested in finding more edge cases that are meaningful to folks. Right, they're not going to make sure that everything works because that's not their stated goal. But they are very interested in broad compatibility. Like they have a on their, I don't know if it's on their GitHub page or on their blog, but basically they have a big grid of like the top 20 PHP language frameworks and whether or not all those language frameworks unit tests passed, website frameworks, so like Drupal and Symfony and Laravel and all these things, and whether or not all of their unit tests pass in HHVM, and they've reached that goal. That was it. They took that goal very seriously. Anything that wasn't working in a core unit test, they would fix. And so I think we will certainly find more things that don't work, but I believe that if we can demonstrate to those people that the things that aren't working are important, they would take a good swag at fixing them. And again, I tested this Panoply. I've also like spot tested a few other websites that I have access to, and have yet to find something that's a show stopping issue that's common in Drupal. But I imagine if we tried to like turn it on for everybody, it would not be a great idea. Yeah.
How about extensions? Have they been tested with, let's say, the Memcache extension or Redis or Tidy or?
Yeah. So there, the extension story is interesting. So there's interoperability with the most of the Zend API, but I know that there are some caveats there. Like it does work. I know it works with Redis. I'm not sure if it works with Tidy or not because I didn't test that specifically. Mm-hmm. But the
XHProf.
XHProf. I'm sure it works with since that's an internal thing that they use there. And I do know that. The one place where I would say HHVM is lacking severely is in good documentation around setup. And like there's like a nice quick start documentation if you just want to give it a try, which I encourage everyone to do. It's not that hard. But like when you want to get deeper into configuring it to do something particular, you have to kind of bang your head against it a little bit to figure it out. I think that will improve by then, but that's not their focus right now. So like for instance, if you go to a PHP info call. In HHVM, it just says hip hop. That's all it tells you. And so they're like, yeah, we'll get around to fixing that, but that's not our priority right now.
I also wanted to say that because it is doing just-in-time compilation, the necessity to actually write something as an extension that's written in native code is far less important. So some people are doing things like just running Redis, which is PHP language implementation of the Redis protocol, and it actually runs extremely well.
Right, and so David's point for the benefit of the recording reels was that because it's doing a just-in-time compilation to a native binary, the performance difference between using a PHP-written library versus a compiled shared object is I don't know if it's negligible or not, but it's much, much reduced, right? So it's because it's able to optimize stuff that's written in PHP to be almost as good as the stuff that's written as a native binary. I actually think that's a pretty important thing for the future of what we're doing with Drupal as we look to include more and more library code from other from like the Symfony world and other components like that as we want to build these sites with Composer. One of the concerns is, well, we ditched a relatively lean Drupal HTTP request call for a relatively fat Guzzle library, and isn't that going to kill performance? And it has an impact on performance, but much less so when you're running this type of engine. So I actually haven't been able to, maybe now that the beta is out, I'll have to rerun all these benchmarks on beta and share them in a blog post or something. That'd probably be worth doing. Other questions? Yeah.
What is the interaction with the software with like Varnish or other reverse proxy software?
It's fine. It basically you can run HHVM as its own web server, and so you have to run it as an FCGI process. So you're running it behind Nginx or something like that anyway.
It's FastCGI anyway.
Yeah. So and then you know it's Varnish is like just totally decoupled. Like Varnish just speaks HTTP and it expects you to send the headers that telling it how long to cache something. And if you send those headers, it really doesn't matter what your backend is. It could be a bash script.
So it's fine with HSVM.
Yeah, totally fine. Yeah.
Hi, my question is about how this may impact Drush or any of the command line tools. Does this affect that, or can it be used in a way to speed up, say, migrations or sort of install scripts and things like that?
So you can run Drush with it. The HHVM binary is a substitute for the PHP command line binary as well. And Drush boots with it. I don't think it will have a huge impact on migrations, since migrations are mostly IO-based operations, and it doesn't optimize IO at all. So like what takes the longest time in a migration is loading the data from one source and then putting it somewhere else. The caveat would be if you're doing like relatively extensive transformations of the data in the middle of that loading process where, you know, you're loading it from one thing, but then you're doing a bunch of manipulation and then saving it out. It could speed up the manipulation part, but I wouldn't expect it to necessarily double the speed of a migration just because most of that time is going to be in IO. Any more for any more? Oh, yes.
How well does it work with Drupal 7? Can we use it?
Well, so I can't guarantee that it will work with your website. The question is, how well will it work with Drupal 7? But Panoply is based on Drupal 7. It's Drupal 7 plus 100 contrib modules, and I didn't have any problems with it. So I think it's really worth – I think that it's going to take more of us trying to use it to figure out what real blockers, if any, there actually are so that we can actually start using this more in production. So my selfish goal for this talk is to try to inspire more people to install this on their own systems and give it a shot. Because I think it could really work for you. And we're not going to find out until more people start like doing a little bit on their own time, figuring out, creating issues where they need to be created and kind of driving more interest around this. I know that the Senso Labs guys are very into it. They're very excited about what this could mean for Symfony. I know that New Relic is working on supporting a plugin for this. So I like to try to say the Drupal community should start taking this project seriously as a potential option. Probably not for like a site that's launching right now. Now, but soon it could happen. Yeah, your question?
Does that mean that you didn't hack anything for your Panoply test?
Nope. Nothing. Had to make zero changes.
Thanks.
Yep. Yeah.
Any examples of sites running right now except for Facebook? Drupal sites?
Oh, Drupal sites? You know, I don't. That's a good question. I don't know. I think one of my – do you have a response?
Yeah, I have one.
Yeah, what site is it? Yeah, let's do it live. Okay. Boom, did you see how fast that was? I'll bet you that was Varnish, though. No, it's the most hipster way imagined. I love this. This is okay. Well, let's bypass some cash though. Oh, that is still very fast. I am impressed, sir. My hat is off. Very cool. I kind of I Like many times, I don't know if you guys have spoken at conferences before, I had lofty goals going into this that I was going to get the new version 3.3. So important note, the hip-hop virtual machine version 3.3 is their long-term support release, which is a one whole year. So that's for them, their motto is move fast and break things. I like to move fast and make things. But 1 year is pretty good for a long-term support release, and so I wanted to benchmark that, and they thought it would be improved because they're doing more to optimize kind of the internal stuff that kind of like slow PHP stuff in their terms. So I wanted to get 3.3 benchmarks out. Wasn't able to do that. I also wanted to get my personal blog running on it because I thought that's a simple, containable enough use case. But now I've got this as a reference, so I guess the pressure's off. anything else? All right, well, thank you so much for having me, and please check this out. I hope you're excited as I am, and have a great DrupalCon. Oh. And rate my session up so I can do this kind of thing again.